Good morning. Welcome to our church family. We are so glad that you could come and share in the worship of God's word and join us in fellowship. We are here with an open heart and God's love to give away. As we worship together today, we hope you leave this place with the peace of God inside. We'll start off with announcements. If anybody does have any announcements, we'll need to come to the lectern. I have a few that I'm going to start off with. Today is Ruby Poole's birthday. And I think we need to sing happy birthday to Ruby, and it's good to have you back, Ruby. Are you ready? Okay, and on another note, Lauren and Luke, correct, had their baby last Monday, Ella James Hatley, 7.5 pounds and 19 inches long. Congratulations to the Boss family. Yes. And of course, the flower on the altar base, please make sure y'all get that to her, okay?
Yeah.
Does
anyone have to sing happy birthday again?
Next year for Ella. That will be her birthday next year. Yeah. Okay. Dakota, it's good to have you back today. Glad your surgery went well. Maya, good to have you back. Yes. Glad you're feeling better. And also, there must be something in the water with these younger kids at this church, because I found out this week that Cameron Bost had appendix surgery as well. So keep her in your prayers as well. The vote on the kitchen, of course, did pass last week, and I did find out this week that Annie Sue Goodman had a stroke. She is still at Rowan Hospital in room 214. She will continue to be there until the 22nd. I did go up and see her on Friday, and believe me, she is checking those dates off on the calendar for her to be able to come home. So, and I was telling Kevin earlier, I got a phone call this week, and you know, you get all those telemarketer calls. Well, it come from Missouri, so therefore, I didn't answer it. Left a voicemail, and I listened to it, and I thought, well, I need to call this lady back. Her name was Donna Pugh. She spells it P-U-G-H. They were in Concord this weekend, and her husband works on MRI machines all over the country. But she's a history buff as well, and she was telling me that her 8th great-grandfather, George Henry Berger, was actually buried in our cemetery. And then she went on to tell me that John Reed, which is, I think, one of the founders of Reed Gold Mine, which is her 4th great-grandfather. So it was very interesting, and she was hoping to be able to be here today for the service, But, of course, she texted me this morning and said that she was not going to be able to be here. But she is wanting to come actually see the church. So I did send her back a message saying that I would be here at 1:30 if she wanted to come in and see the church. And, of course, Kevin has offered to come back if for some reason she does show up to give her a little history lesson as well. So thank you, Kevin, for doing that. Okay, any other announcements? And I'll be quiet.
All righty, pastoral search. We are making headway. We've got about five applicants that we're looking at. So let's get together this Thursday and see if we can move forward with some of this stuff. So this Thursday, I'm sorry, this Thursday, 7:00 in the historical room.
To bring you up to speed with building and ground events that are taking place, I guess you can see that the exterior painting of the church has been completed. Richard's painting and myself had a walkthrough this past Friday, and everything really went well. I think it looks great. They came back, took care of all the divots that the lift made in the ground with product and seed and straw. Did a really good job with this, so I was appreciative of them. They are going to pay for the repair of this tombstone that was accidentally knocked over, so that'll be taken care of there. Tomorrow morning, first thing, Tony Brown will be in with his painting crew to start work on the wall and the cracks that you see around in the path in the plaster. Be aware that depending on their timeline and what it takes to repair all this, we may be meeting in the educational building next Sunday because they're going to have to build scaffolding on this front wall to take care of this stuff. So just be prepared for that. Everything else is good right now. No loose screws that I know of around anyway.
I lowered the lectern for my purposes, but yeah. Oops. Okay. Now we'll stand and sing our opening hymn in a green hymnal, Redeemed, page 356. Yeah, the green hymnals may be under the benches.
Redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child.
please remain standing for the call to worship. Happy are those who follow the ways of the Lord.
God's ways are just and merciful.
Those who follow God's ways are continually nourished in faith.
In all that they do, they prosper.
Come, let us open our hearts to God's compassionate love. Let us celebrate God's mercy and justice. Amen. Because we trust in God's covenant faithfulness, we are free to make our confession to God and call for his compassion. Let us therefore confess our sins that we may be renewed in his grace. Join me in the prayer of confession. O holy and most merciful God, in your presence we confess our sinfulness, our shortcomings, and our offenses against you. You alone know how often we have sinned in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love. Have mercy on us, O Lord, for we are ashamed and sorry for all we have done to displease you. Forgive our sins and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. There is one announcement I failed to make, and sorry about that, Brenda. The EMS fundraiser in memory of Samantha Harkey is Saturday, September the 14th from 11 to 2. Of course, you have to buy your tickets in advance, correct, Brenda? $10 a plate. That includes bean slaw, a half a chicken, bread, and dessert, and it's carry out only. So make sure you get your tickets by September the 8th. Now we'll have the music ministry. Ushers would please come forward. God is the great giver. He gives life, health, and happiness, work, strength, and all things bright and beautiful. Give today, remembering all God's blessings.
Oh.
Now we have the children's message by David Maxwell. So the children come forward.
Good morning. All right. I collect coins. I'm not a super professional about it, but, you know, I'm 50 years old, and every now and then when I come across something cool, I like to put it in my pocket and take it out of circulation and just keep it because it's a valuable coin. And I got some I wanted to share with you guys today. I'm going to save the best one for last. Okay. Good for you. Well, so the first one I want to show you, this is a Susan B. Anthony dollar. You ever seen these things before? They came out in 1979. They don't make them anymore because people always got them confused for quarters. But actually, this is worth a dollar. And Susan B. Anthony was a pretty cool woman. She was about equal rights for people. She stood up against slavery, and she stood up for women's rights, too, and said, you know what? Women should have the right to vote just like men do. So because of people like her, a woman can run for president now if she wants to. So the world, we've come a long way in equal rights. And I came by these things by, there was this man, I was a bellhop in a motel, and I would take stuff to the rooms. And this one old dude was a long-time resident there. He was kind of cool. And he would always tip me with the Susan B. Anthony. He'd be like, here you go, sonny. Have you there. And now I get to do it, too. So one for you. Here you go, sonny. And here you go, sonny. Now, you guys, don't spend that on candy, all right? Put that somewhere and save it. You want to come get it? All right. Oh, don't make me lean over. You want one, too? Come get it. All right. What do you call it? Sonny is a boy's nickname. What do you call a girl? Here you go, sweetie. All right. So hang on to those and put them somewhere. Now your coin collection dales up to $2.65. All right. So this is just a regular old penny. Well, it looks like a regular old penny, and this came across. It's a wheat penny. And exactly, they don't make them anymore. But I looked at this, and the date was faded off when I finally could see it. It's a 1911 penny. So that's over 100 years old. I said, you know what? I'm going to put that in my collection because that's been around the block a time or two. A golden penny. No. No. Do you have a gold penny?
I did, but I lost my
chicken. Ooh. Oh, man. Well, this is actually, we'll come back to that. This is a nickel. If you look on there, instead of Thomas Jefferson, it's got a Native American Indian on the head side, and the tail side is a buffalo. So this thing's from 1914. That's a long time ago. If you look up that list there, you got to go up a ways to, well, it looks like we didn't have a preacher during that year, but 1914. But my favorite one I really wanted to show you guys is my Mercury dime. I found it, I was probably y'all's age, and I found it laying on the sidewalk outside the parsonage in Berryville, Virginia. And even back then I knew it was a special coin. So I wanted to share that with you. If I can find it. That's right. Oh no. Oh no, I think I've lost it. This is terrible. This is, yeah, you know how it feels. It's a crummy feeling, isn't it? Oh my goodness. Yeah, let me go over here where I was sitting. Oh man. Let's see. Hang on a second. Somebody left a flashlight and a broom here. This is not good at all. Where on earth could, wait. Oh my goodness.
I think I see it, David.
You think you see it?
I think I see it.
You're right.
Yep.
How did it get there? Oh, my goodness. But anyway.
It jumped out of your pocket right over there.
You think so?
Oh, man, I'm so happy. I'm going to hug you guys. Who would be hugging?
I think that's it. But this story is actually not about this coin at all. It's a way I try to bring to life a story that Jesus told, and I want to share that with you guys here. Suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. So what's these stories about? Jesus' story of the lost coin and my story of the lost coin. What do you think that's really about? Jesus wasn't talking about a coin, really. Anybody want to get? Amen, Dale. You are one smart kid. You are one smart kid. That's right. That story is about Jesus loves us so much. You guys don't, we don't realize just how much God loves us. He loves every single one of us. He loves you, your mommy, daddy, brothers, sisters. We're all precious to him. Cousins, everybody, no matter what country you're from, anything. He loves you dearly. You are precious to him. And we should share that message. When you guys go to school or your parents go to work, we should tell them about God's love for us, his deep, profound love for us that he showed us through Jesus Christ, his son. All right. Well, let's pray. I'll let you guys go. And remember, don't spend that money on candy. Try to save it and start your own coin collection, all right? Did you lose it too? It fell down your pants? How does that happen? Do a little jiggle, shake it. All right. All right. All right. Well, let's pray and let you guys go. Thank you for being such a good audience. Dear God, we'll find it. Let's just say thank you to God. Say, we love you so much, and thank you for loving us so much, too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Now we'll have the pastoral prayer by Reverend Maxwell.
Thank you, son. If you've ever wondered how to put together a prayer, let me give you a simple structure, P-R-A-Y. Praise, repent, ask, and yield. With that in mind, let's pray. Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is for us to say that. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us into your family. And thank you, too, that you're such a good father to us. Please forgive us where we, as your children, have perhaps embarrassed you, disappointed you, or whatever. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your abundant grace. And thank you for the forgiveness that you so freely give to us as we confess our sins. Our prayer is for a world in such desperate need We pray for those who are in the world and striving to do right, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you in service. We bring our own concerns before you this morning and thank you that you're willing to listen to us. We're so grateful that your ear is always open to us and that your heart is for us. And so we come to you with our various concerns and we lay them before you and we thank you for what you're willing to do for us. Accept, we pray, our dedication as we renew it and yield ourselves anew to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hymn of worship is number 283 in the red hymnal, God is Our Refuge.
Now we will have the scripture reading read by Reverend Maxwell.
I've decided to read Psalm 5 instead of Psalm 1 this morning, and I've decided to read it from the King James Version of the Bible. It's not that I have any objection to any other versions. In fact, I've rarely use the King James myself, but I think when it comes to the Psalms, you can't find more beauty than in the old King James. So this is Psalm 5. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God, for unto thee will I pray. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look up. For thou art not a God that hath pleasure in wickedness, neither shall evil dwell with thee. The foolish shall not stand in thy sight. Thou hatest all workers of iniquity. Thou shalt destroy them that speak leasing. The Lord will abhor the bloody and deceitful man. But as for me, I will come into thy house in the multitude of thy mercy, and in thy fear will I worship toward thy holy temple. Lead me, O Lord, in thy righteousness because of mine enemies. Make thy way straight before my face. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. They flatter with their tongue. Destroy thou them, O God, and let them fall by their own counsels. Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions, for they have rebelled against thee. But let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee. For thou, Lord, wilt bless the righteous. With favor wilt thou compass him as with a shield.
Please stand for the glory of Patri.
I really do think, which reminds me of something I read about an elderly lady who in a very pensive moment said, sometimes I sits and thinks. And then she continued, and sometimes I just sits. Well, she's not alone in that. Sometimes I sits and thinks. And there are also those times when I just sits. With this Sunday in mind, as I sat and thought, I thought about the Psalms. There are 150 of them, if you care to count them. There are five books or collections, and they're all consolidated into one book, which is called the Psalter, P-S-A-L-T-E-R, Psalter. Or it's called simply the Book of Psalms. And this book of antiquity contains the favorite hymns and the favorite prayers of ancient Israel that were used in their worship of God. Of course, we too use the Psalms, do we not, in our worship of God. I just read from the fifth Psalm, and that song we just sang, I think, is based on, I believe it's Psalm 90, but I'm not absolutely sure about that, but it is based on one of the Psalms. They're read in our services, they're taught, they're preached, they are prayed sometimes, and they are also sung on occasion. In fact, there was a time in the history of the church when only the Psalms were considered suitable for use in the worship of God. We don't think that way anymore, but as most of us don't. But we do have the Psalms in our hymnal, not only as responsive readings, but also as the basis for some of the hymns that we sing. I looked at my 1991 issue of the Baptist hymnal, and there I discovered that 133 of the 666 songs that we sing from that hymnal are based upon psalm texts. I looked in the red hymnal to see how many of those were taken from psalm texts, but they don't list the scriptures that are the basis for the hymns that are used there. Sometimes we use the Psalms for singing, congregational singing. They're called metrical psalms. And somebody, a friend of mine who was the United Methodist, gave me a copy of the Methodist hymnal. And in that I found a metrical version of Psalm 23, which is in the hymnal, set to music, and it's there for congregational singing. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me the quiet waters by, so forth and so on. So the Psalter is a very, very versatile book of the Bible. And whatever mood you happen to be in, there is more than likely a corresponding psalm. I found this written. The Psalms address the full range of experiences in our walk with God. Virtually every possible human emotion and spiritual condition are reflected in the Psalms. No matter what we're going through or how we feel, God can use the Psalms to reveal himself and his truth, to give us a verbal means of expression even, and possibly even to enable us to cope with whatever it is that's troubling us. The Psalms express before God the full range of human experience and emotion: anger, despair, grief, self-loathing, praise, repentance, confession, anxiety, hope. One of the most striking features of the Psalms to me is the transparency of the poets, that is, those who composed these Psalms. They're honest. And as you heard from Psalm 5, they're very forthright. Sometimes they're even shocking in their content. And sometimes you have to remind yourself that these were written within the community faith. The psalmists don't beat around the bush. They don't sugarcoat things either. They tell it like it is, or at least as it appears to them to be. I grew up in a pietistic religious tradition. Worshipped in a tradition of the Pennsylvania Germans. And one of the things you never did in that tradition was to express your anger toward God, or your disappointment, or your frustration. And you certainly never questioned God. I don't believe that anymore. Because I've read the book of Psalms, and God is the one who's seen to it that these Psalms are put into this book we call the Bible. And I think God really prefers our integrity. Don't you? I think God really prefers that we be honest and transparent with him instead of showing pretense. Because God sees through it anyway, does he not? Now, that doesn't mean that we countenance belligerence or disrespect in addressing God. After all, we remember who it is we're talking to. But I do think God wants us to do that. And I think we can take our cue from that by a reading of the Psalms. The Psalms are excellent sources of devotional reading, too. I read that it's not in the New Testament that the greatest devotional literature is found, but in the Old, in the book of Psalms. Here, more than any place in the Bible, the heart throb of the saint is heard. Here are the most exalted expressions of God's greatness. Here are the bitterest groans of the sinful and afflicted. Here is something for someone in every mood. You know, Paul, as well as Jesus, quoted the Psalms. If you look at the letters of Paul, you will find quotations from the Psalms. And even Jesus, in those agonizing hours of crucifixion, quoted from the 22nd Psalm. and from the 31st Psalm, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Billy Graham read them devotionally. He said he read them devotionally to bring him into the presence of God. I've got a little book, a little green Broadman book. It's an old book. Most of my books are old. But I had a seminary professor who told us how to identify a good book. He said, pick it up, smell it. If it has the smell of age, it's a good book. Well, my library reeks. Well, Billy Smith, in this little book, Never Alone, in which he treats several of the familiar psalms that we know and love, says in the preface, through whatever experience the psalmist was going, he regularly sensed that God was with him. God was not away in the heavens, unaware, unconcerned, unavailable. Rather, he manifested himself wherever the psalmist was, whatever his circumstances. He said he was never alone. In your room at night, in the ICU unit of the hospital, standing over the grave of a loved one, surrounded by a faceless crowd, you're never alone. The Psalms reflect a deep awareness of God's presence, not way up there, but nearer, he says, than the blood that courses through your veins and the air that fills your lungs. God is here and near. So, in conclusion, I hope that the Psalms will be an open book for you, that you'll read them, that you'll meditate on them, maybe even, when the occasion warrants, you'll pray them. But above all, you'll let the Psalms usher you in through your reading to the very presence of Holy God. So, here is an approach to ensure the reality and the recognition of God's presence each day. It goes like this. I met God in the morning when my day was at its best, and his presence came like sunrise, like a glory in my breast. All day long, the presence lingered. All day long, he stayed with me, and we sailed in perfect calmness o'er a very troubled sea. Other ships were blown and battered. Other ships were sore distressed. But the winds that seemed to drive them brought to us a peace and rest. Then I thought of other mornings with a keen remorse of mind, when I too had loosed the moorings with the presence left behind. So I think I know the secret, learned from many a troubled way. You must seek him in the morning if you want him through the day. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I lift my prayer unto thee, and will look up. Our hymn is number 232 in the red hymnal. Number 232.
Make it mine.
establish you, above to shelter you, behind to forward you, before to guide you, round about to embrace you in his love, and secure you by his grace.